వెల్కమ్ టు ఈ పాఠశాల ఇన్ లింగ్విస్టిక్స్. వీఆర్ గోయింగ్ టు డిస్కస్ సమ్ ఎవిడెన్స్ ఇన్ సపోర్ట్ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా యాజ్ ఎ లింగ్విస్టిక్ ఏరియా. వీఆర్ గోయింగ్ టు ప్రజెంట్ సమ్ ఫర్దర్ ఎవిడెన్స్ ఇన్ సపోర్ట్ ఆఫ్ దిస్ నోషన్. వాట్ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ ఎవిడెన్స్ కెన్ బి డ్యూస్డ్ ఇన్ సపోర్ట్ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా యాజ్ ఎ లింగ్విస్టిక్ ఏరియా? యాజ్ యూ మైట్ రికాల్, వెన్ వీ సే ఇండియా యాజ్ ఎ లింగ్విస్టిక్ ఏరియా, ఇర్రెస్పెక్టివ్ ఆఫ్ ద ఫ్యాక్ట్ వెదర్ ద లాంగ్వేజ్ బిలాంగ్స్ టు ఇండో ఆరియన్ ఆర్ టిబెటో బర్మన్ ఆర్ ఆస్ట్రో ఏషియాటిక్ దట్ ఈస్ మాన్కమేర్ అండ్ ముండా ఆర్ ద్రవిడియన్, ఆల్ దీస్ లాంగ్వేజెస్ షేర్ సర్టన్ కామన్ ఫీచర్స్ ఇర్రెస్పెక్టివ్ ఆఫ్ దేర్ ఫ్యామిలీ. సో వాట్ వీఆర్ గోయింగ్ టు సీ, వీ హ్యావ్ సీన్ ఈకో వర్డ్స్ రీడ్యూప్లికేషన్ ఎట్సెట్రా when we were discussing about the notion of India as a linguistic area in the earlier unit. Now we are going to present further evidence in terms of the quotative construction and also what is the parametric variation that is found in South Asian languages. Is this variation very unique or is it part of the universal grammar? So next, first we will discuss, in this unit we will discuss the nature of the quotative construction. The quotative is a construction, the quotative is derived from the verb say, is a complementizer, and we are going to discuss the nature of this complementizer, and we are going to discuss the parametric variation found in South Asian languages. Some of the parameters that we are going to discuss are the pro-drop parameter, free word order in South Asian languages, the absence of expletive expressions, and the absence of superiority effects. The quotative is a form, either a conjunctive participle form or an infinitival form derived from the verb to say, and it is used as a final complementizer or a post-sentential complementizer in finite clauses. Where does the quotative occur? In English, the complementizer, as you know, it occurs to the left of the embedded clause. John told me that he is too busy preparing for his exam. So that is a complementizer that links the main clause and the subordinate clause, and it occurs to the left of the embedded clause that he is too busy preparing for his exams. So that is the linker. You can say complementizer is basically a linker that links the subordinate clause and the main clause when the main clause can take a complement. What are the verbs that can take a complement? The verbs such as tell, say, write, mention. John told me that he would come. John wrote to me that he would come. John mentioned it to me that he would come, etc., etc. So, provided you have a matrix verb that is capable of taking an embedded clause, the embedded clause is a finite clause, and the matrix verb in the matrix clause is a finite verb, these two are linked by means of a complementizer. This complementizer can occur either to the left of the embedded clause or to the right of the embedded clause. In English, it occurs to the left of the embedded clause. In a language such as Hindi or Urdu or Kashmiri or Bangla or Konkani or Marathi, it occurs to the left of the embedded clause. In Hindi, it is ki, Ram ne kaha, Ram said ki main Delhi ja raha hoon, I am going to Delhi. So Ram ne kaha is your matrix clause. Kehna takes a complement. The complement is I am going to Delhi. Ram said that I am going to Delhi, that is he is going to Delhi, or it could be I am going to Delhi, the speaker. We will discuss this later. However, the complementizer in some languages may occur to the right of the embedded clause, as it does in all Tibeto-Burman languages and in all Dravidian languages, in contrast to Indo-Aryan languages, where you have the complementizer occurring either to the right or to the left. When it occurs to the right of the embedded clause, in the languages in which it does, it is called a quotative because it is derived from the verb to say. The quotative is not unique to the South Asian subcontinent. It is found elsewhere in African languages too. And the occurrence of the quotative as a complementizer to the right of the embedded verb is totally consistent and harmonic with SOV word order. That is, the unmarked position of a complementizer in a verb final language is to its right. The unmarked position of the complementizer in a non-verb final language is to the left. So in Hindi, Punjabi or Bangla, when you have a complementizer such as ki or j in Bangla occurring to the left, it is non-harmonic and it is not consistent. Not all South Asian languages have the quotative as a complementizer. As I mentioned just now, it is the Tibeto-Burman languages, it is the Dravidian languages, it is the Munda languages that have the complementizer. Some of the Indo-Aryan languages, such as Nepali, does not have an initial complementizer. It only has a final complementizer, a complementizer that is derived from the verbs say. And you have, that is Bhanera in Nepali. And you have in Assamese, Buli, Bangla, Buli, and in Konkani, Manun, in Marathi, Manun, in Dakhini Hindi, Bolke, Ram, Mai Aavanga Karke, or Ram, Mai Aavanga Bolke, Ram ne likha, Ram likho. So, you have the complementizer that is found not only in Indo-Aryan languages, not only in Dravidian and Tibeto-Burman languages, but also in some Indo-Aryan languages. Notice that in Khasi, you have a complementizer, ba, that occurs to the left, and Khasi does not have any complementizer that occurs to the right, which is predictable. Why? Because Khasi is a verb medial language. The quotative is also found in Sanskrit. It has the form of iti. Iti literally means thus, but in course of time it is grammaticalized and it became a complementizer and it became a final or right peripheral or a complementizer that occurs to the right of the embedded clause like that does the quotative occurs. So you can roughly say Sanskrit has the quotative though the form is not derived from the verb say. There are several functions that the quotative performs. We are going to discuss this. It functions as a reason marker, it functions as a purpose marker, it functions as in naming and labeling. And all these functions are due to a process called grammaticalization. We shall now discuss the various functions of the quotative in South Asian languages. In Malayalam and in Mizo, the embedded clause with a finite complementizer may occur to the left of the matrix subject or to the right. Okay, let me explain what I mean by that. In Hindi, you have Ram ne kaha, Ram said, ki, that, mai Delhi ja raha hun. Ki is an initial complementizer. It occurs to the left of the embedded clause, so it's called a left peripheral complementizer. Ram ne kaha, kaha is the matrix verb, and ki mai Delhi ja raha hun is occurs to the right of the matrix verb. It is also possible that the embedded clause might occur in its in situ position. What do we mean by that? Ram ne kaha. Ram said something. Where does something come? In Hindi, the verb, Hindi is a, in Hindi the verb comes to the direct object comes to the left of the verb. So, Ram ne kuch kaha. Ram said something. So, the where the position, where kuch occurs, that is the in situ position for the embedded clause. That means the sentence is, Ram ne ki mai Delhi ja raha hoon kaha. But there is a constraint in these languages where ki, that I am going to Delhi, my Delhi ja raha hoon, cannot occur in its original position, in situ position. It is obligatorily moved to the right of the verb of the matrix clause. So this I have labeled as complementizer push in 1984 in Hindi. Now let us proceed and see. In Malayalam, interestingly, in Hindi, notice that ki mai Delhi ja raha hoon, Ram ne kaha, cannot be said. Why? Ki mai Delhi, Ram mai Delhi ja raha hoon is an embedded clause. Ram ne kaha is the main clause. It cannot occur to the left of the subject of the matrix clause. It cannot occur in its in situ position. It can occur only to the right of the matrix verb. In Dravidian languages and in Tibeto-Burma languages, interestingly, you can have the embedded clause occurring in its in situ position or to the right of the verb of the matrix clause or to the left of the subject of the matrix clause. That means for every complement clause with the complementizer where it is a quotative, there you can have three choices. Let's take this example from Malayalam. Kutti Urangi Enna Amma Parinyu. Kutti, child, Urangi, slept, Enna, N is the verb to say, the conjunctive participle form of verb to say is Enna. So Enna occurs to the right of the embedded clause as we expect. It is called a final complementizer. Now, Amma Parinyu. Amma is the subject of the matrix clause. Parinyu is the matrix verb. So where does the embedded clause occur? The embedded clause occurs to the left of the matrix subject. It is also conceivable to have the embedded clause Kutti Urangi Enna occurring in its in situ position, namely in the position of the direct object of the matrix clause. That is, Amma Kutti Urangi Enna Parinyu. Amma, that the child is sleeping, said. What is the third possible position? The third possible position is to the left, to the right of the matrix verb, like in Hindi or like in English. He told me that the child is sleeping. Usne kaha ki bachcha so raha hai. Here you can have in Malayalam, Amma Parinyu Kutti Urangi Enna. Amma Parinyu Kutti Urangi Enna. That means you have three positions. The same thing is possible, permitted, the same kind of movement or occurrence is permitted in all Dravidian languages and in Tibeto-Burman languages. Now let me proceed to the various functions that the conjunctive participle and the verb say, the complementizer performs in Dravidian languages. In Dravidian languages and in Mundari, it can work as a reason marker, it can work as a like as it can give the interpretation of because. Let us see the example from Sinhala. By the way, I forgot to mention, Sinhala is an Indo-Aryan language. It's a verifinal language spoken in Sri Lanka, and it has a complementizer, Kiala, that occurs to the right of the embedded clause, and it is a quotative form, which means it is derived from the verb to say. So Kiala means having said. So let's look at this sentence. We made the cake on father's birthday. That is, since it was his birthday, or realizing that it was his birthday, we made a cake. Tatage upandina kela api cake hadwa. Let me repeat it again. Tatage, father's upandina birthday kela. If I translate it into Hindi, something like bolke. Pitaji ka birthday hai bolke. Api, we, cake, hadwa. We made a cake. We made a cake because it was father's birthday. That means kiala not only functions like a complementizer in a sentence as a linker, but it can also work as a reason marker. This kind of reason marker is found in Sanskrit too. Let's look at this sentence in 26. Vaideshikaha asmi iti prichami. What is the subject of the matrix clause? I am asking. But in Sanskrit is a heavy protodrop language, because prichami tells you that the subject is first person singular. Okay, so the subject is dropped. What is the subject of the embedded clause? That too is protodropped. Why? Vaideshikaha, stranger or foreigner, asmi, I am. So it's protodropped. As we have seen, protodrop is a very robust phenomenon in South Asian languages. So here you have Vaideshika asmi iti. Iti that we have talked about a few moments ago, which means thus, occurs here as a final complementizer to the right of the embedded clause, and does not have the meaning of a complementizer. That since I am a stranger, it has the interpretation of since. By the way, in Sanskrit, iti started out to be as initial complementizer, then slowly in course of time it became a final complementizer. That is, there is a radical shift of the complementizer iti from left to right, which could possibly due to Dravidian influence, because Dravidian and Tibeto-Burman languages only have a final complementizer. They do not have an initial complementizer. So the shift of position of iti in Sanskrit from the initial left peripheral to the right peripheral, to the right of the embedded verb, could be due to the influence of Dravidian languages. Then next one we move to the complementizer functioning like as a purpose marker. What do you mean by purpose marker? Purpose is purposive adverb, in order to or to. Why are you going to Agra? To see Taj Mahal, which means in order to see the Taj Mahal. So when you get an answer for why, the answer should be a kind of purpose or reason. In this case, I came in order to see Khumti. It's a sentence from Kokborok. Kokborok is a Tibeto-Burman language spoken in Tripura, and it's a verifinal language. So you have sentence such as Ang Khumti no Naika Huni Paika. Hun is the verb to say, E is the conjunctive participle, Ui is the conjunctive participle, Huni means having said, I Kumti accusative C, and the verb C is in its infinitive form, nai na. Then you have the complementizer, pai ka, I came. Why did you come here? I came in order to see Kumti. So this is a purposive interpretation. And who is giving this interpretation? It is the quotative that is imparting the purposive interpretation. The quotative can also function as an identifier. In Sanskrit, it functions in naming and labeling, in Marathi, Assamese, and in all Dravidian languages, and in some Tibeto-Burman languages, the quotative functions like in naming and labeling. What exactly do we mean by naming and labeling? Indira, a person named Indira came here. In English, I am using the verb name. You take the noun and make it into a verb. A person named Indira came here. But in Dravidian languages, in Tibeto-Burman languages, and in Sanskrit, you can have the quotative functioning like an identifier. Indira ane manishi ikkadiki vachindi. This is from Telugu, a Dravidian language. Indira, proper name. An is the verb to say. A is the habitual form of the participle, habitual marker for the participle. Ane, Indira ane, manishi, person, a person named Indira, ikkadiki, here to, vachindi, came. Notice that I am not using the verb name. What is the verb I am using? I am using the quotative form of the verb to say, namely an. An is the quotative form. An is the verb to say, and in its conjunctive participle form, it is used as a quotative. In the next section of our talk, we are going to discuss the nature of parametric variation that is found in South Asian languages. There are language universals, there are parameters, and languages differ from each other, not in an innumerable number of parameters, but in a limited number of parameters. For example, as you might know, that in South Asian languages, pronouns can be dropped, either subject or direct object or indirect object. What did we call this? Prodrop parameter. So South Asian languages are plus prodrop languages, and languages such as English or French, where you cannot drop the pronoun, they are called minus prodrop languages. So we are going to now discuss the parameters according to which South Asian languages differ from other languages, and what we are going to show, the parameters that we are going to discuss are all shared by all South Asian languages. That means, if you have a parameter like prodrop in Dravidian languages, the chances are you would find it in Indo-Aryan, you will find it in Dravidian, you will find it in Tibeto-Burman, you will find it in Munda, you will find it in Mon-Khmer, etc. So here, whether the language is verb final or whether the language is verb medial like Khasi, absolutely there is no difference in terms of the parameters that are shared. How do we view a parameter? We talked about verb final languages, verb medial languages, verb initial languages. That itself is a parameter in word order. That is, you have verb in the final position, verb in the medial position, verb in the initial position. That is, the position of the verb could be a parameter that can be characterized in terms of word order. Some languages drop pronouns optionally, while some languages do not permit the prodrop. Based on that, the distinction is called prodrop parameter. So, what are the parameters that we are going to discuss now? Null pronominals and their relation to the absence of an overt subject, object with transitive verbs, and optional deletion in some other constituents. Relatively free word order, marked absence of superiority effects, the absence of tense and person harmony in complement clauses, etc. All Dravidian languages and all languages have morphologically uniform inflectional paradigm. Whether the language has agreement or no agreement, pro-drop is permitted. For example, you have Manipuri or you have Rabha, you have Tangkul, where there is no verb agreement, still pro-drop is permitted. However, in some languages, only very few, for example, take Tenidiye, also called as Angami, pro-drop is obligatory. Pro-drop of the matrix, the embedded subject is obligatory when the embedded subject is co-indexed with the matrix subject. Let's look at this sentence. The Feng told me that he would go to Shillong. This sentence could be ambiguous. The Feng told me that he would go to Shillong. It could have a sentential referent, that is, it refers to the Feng, or it could be a discourse referent, that it does, he could be someone else. So here let us assume for a second, the Feng told me that the Feng would go to Shillong. That means the matrix subject and the embedded subject are co-indexed and there is coreference between these two. When there is coreference between these two, how does a sentence in Angami look like? The Feng A pro Shillong nu Votyo idi akipu. The Feng A is the nominative marker. Pro occurs in the embedded subject position. Shillong nu, to Shillong. Wo is to go. Kyo is the future marker. Idi is the complementizer. Aki, to me. A and ki, pu, told me. Now, where does your embedded sentence occur? Your embedded clause occurs in situ, that is to the left of the matrix verb. And notice that the pro occurs as the embedded subject. The embedded subject is pro-dropped. And this embedded subject is obligatorily pro-dropped. If the speaker wants to have coreference with the subject. If you wish to have coreference with the matrix subject, then the embedded subject must be obligatorily pro-dropped. The question that arises now is, what happens if the pronoun he or whatever the pronoun in Angami may be is overtly present? If it is overtly present, then it cannot have coreference. It means someone else will go to Shillong, not the speaker. Take a sentence from Telugu and see how pro-drop operates in our languages. Have you written a letter to him? The sentence in Telugu would be Meeru to him Ayanaki Uttaram letter Rasera. Have you written a letter to him? In Telugu, I can simply say wrote. I can simply say the verb rasenu. I don't even have to say avunu. Avunu means yes. Pro, the subject is pro-dropped in 31. The indirect object is pro-dropped. The direct object is pro-dropped. So you have yes, yes, wrote or simply wrote. In English, you cannot have pro-drop, and when you have a transitive verb, you have to have the direct object overtly present. Have you written a letter to him? In English, of course you can say yes I did, but if you want to use the verb to write overtly, yes I wrote it. But in English I cannot say I wrote. But the common structure that you find in Indian languages, no matter what the what language the speaker speaks, you have "yes, I wrote," or simply "I wrote." Why does this happen? This happens because prodrop is a very robust phenomenon in our languages, and when we speak English, we ignore the rule of English, namely, when your verb is transitive, you cannot have prodrop. This is similar to Angami or Terijee, where the embedded subject cannot be prodropped. But of course, in Angami, you can have prodrop very freely, except in the case where when the embedded subject and matrix subject are coreferential. Another parameter that we have in South Asian languages is free word order. In Indo-Aryan, in Dravidian, in Munda languages, constituents in a sentence can be freely moved or scrambled. In Tibeto-Burman languages, movement is there, but it is not as free as you find in Munda or Tibeto-Burman or Dravidian or Indo-Aryan languages. Let's take a sentence like, "Whom did you see?" "Aapne kisko dekha tha?" "Aapne," you, "kisko," whom, "dekha tha," see, saw. So you have, "Whom did you see?" "Aapne kisko dekha tha." The scrambling would be, "Kisko aapne dekha?" "Dekha tha kisko aapne?" All the constituents can be scrambled without any restriction on the movement. However, why do we have the movement? Suppose when the direct object is moved to the initial position, "kisko aapne dekha tha," that means we want the focus, "kisko." So movement, such movement can bring a constituent into focus when it occurs in the initial position. Now let's take mizo. As I mentioned a moment ago, mizo or some Tibeto-Burman languages do not have free word order to the extent that we have in Dravidian or Indo-Aryan languages. Let's take this example. Rini eats food. You have Rini, the subject, food, the direct object, verb, eat. So, Rinin, so I, that is Rini eats food. The direct object is so, food. It can be fronted. So, Rinin I, that is food Rini eats. The verb can be fronted too, but it's not a very acceptable sentence in mezo. I so Rinin. The mezo native speaker does not prefer it. Lekin, let's look at Hindi. In Hindi, I can say, "Khaya to Ram ne sab kuch." As for eating, khaya, ate. As for eating, as for ate. Okay, Ram ne, Ram ergative, khaya, khaya to Ram ne sab kuch, everything. So you can bring the verb to the initial position, either in Indo-Aryan languages or in Dravidian languages, very freely, without any problem. The next thing that we are going to discuss is superiority effects. In your syntax class, you must have discussed what superiority aspects are. Superiority aspects relate to question expressions in a sentence. When two or more than two WH phrases compete with each other for movement to a given site, it is the superior or higher constituent or MP or the WH phrase that moves and takes the initial position. That is, you know there is a hierarchy of subject, direct object, indirect object, oblique object, etc. So who is at the top of the hierarchy? Subject is at the top of the hierarchy. If you have a question questioning who gave what to whom, who is the subject of the class. Give is the verb. What is the direct object? To whom is the indirect object? Suppose you have some oblique object also. Who gave what to whom when? In Hindi, in English, there is a neat hierarchy. How many phrases can be moved? Who can be moved to the front? What can be moved to the front, to the spec position? To whom can be moved to the spec position? When can be moved to the spec position? But what can move in English? Only who can move. Why? Who? The subject, the question expression that questions the subject is hierarchically higher than the question words that question the direct object or the indirect object or the oblique object. So, it is expected due to superiority effects that whenever you have, when two WH phrases compete with each other for movement to a given site, that is to the site of the spec, it is the superior or the higher WH phrase that moves and that takes that position. Here in our case, in English, it is the subject. But do we have superiority effects in Hindi or in any South Asian language? The answer is no. That is, in the spec position of the clause, you can have the direct object, that the question word that questions the direct object, or the question word that questions the indirect object, or the subject, or the oblique object, and there is no hierarchy. When you say who gave what to whom and when, who subject, next the one that can occur is direct object, what, the next one that can occur is to whom, indirect object, when, that can occur in the final position, that is the oblique object or the adverb. In Hindi or in any South Asian languages, any South Asian language, you can have, take an example such as 39, kisko, kab, kyon, kaise, kya, kaun dega, isse, mujhe, matlab nahi, or mere ko matlab nahi in colloquial Hindi. Okay? So this kisko, indirect object, kab, when, that is the question expression questioning a time adverb, kyon, again an adverb questioning the purpose, kaise, how, a manner adverb, question word questioning a manner, kya, in a question expression questioning the direct object, kaun, which normally occurs in the position, which should occur in the subject position, in the first position, initial position of the sentence. If Hindi follows the superiority effects constraint, that but kaun occurs almost at the end, not almost, it's at the end. So this sentence beautifully demonstrates that Indian languages do not follow any hierarchy or superiority effects, and it can come in any order. Why do you think this is happening? Recall that in Indian languages we have free word order. So the same principle of free word order is operating here when you have question words, and your question words can be easily scrambled. Let us look at the English sentence. I don't care who will give what to whom, how and when. But in Hindi, literally, I do not care whom, when, why, how, what, who will give you. Okay? We shall now proceed to the next point. In English, there is a principle in textbooks that you find, grammar books, that there is a principle of tense harmony between the tense of the matrix verb and the tense of the embedded verb. So, when you are in school, your teachers would say, John told me he will come tomorrow. Notice that told is in past tense, that's your matrix verb. Will come is the embedded verb, and will is in present tense, it's a future marker, but it is morphologically a present form. But tell and told and will are not compatible. Why? In English there is a rule that John told me that he would come tomorrow. When you were learning English, or I was learning English, we always felt, how could would be a marker for future? And would is a past tense form of the verb will. Here, would comes or occurs because your matrix verb is told. So you have John told me that he would come tomorrow. Right? So that means English strictly follows the tense harmony. However, in colloquial English, sometimes this tense harmony constraint is violated. Again, from Hindi Urdu, बच्चों ने लिखा था कि हम छुट्टियों में शिमला जाएंगे. Literally, बच्चों ने children लिखा था, wrote, हम छुट्टियों में, we in the holidays, शिमला जाएंगे, will go. The children wrote that we will go to Shimla in the holidays. This is the literal meaning. Where लिखा था is past perfect, जाएंगे is future, and there is no tense harmony at all in Hindi. In English, what would be a formal sentence? The children wrote that they would go to Shimla in the holidays. So that means English follows the tense harmony, strict the tense harmony constraint, whereas Indian languages do not follow the constraint at all. This can be checked if you want to check with your in your mother tongue or any other Indian language. Let's take a sentence such as Sarita told me that she will meet me tomorrow. Sarita is the subject in third person, and the subject of the embedded clause is she. It can be co-indexed with the subject. Sarita told me that Sarita will go to tomorrow, will meet me tomorrow, or it could be a discourse antecedent where she could refer to someone else. So Sarita had told me that she would meet me the next day. This is the formal English expression. In English, Indian English, or in Indian language, I can also say Sarita told me that I will meet him tomorrow. That I could be co-referent with Sarita, co-referential with Sarita, the matrix subject, or it could be co-referential with me, the object, indirect object of the matrix clause. So such sentences create ambiguity when we speak English. Sarita told me that I will meet her tomorrow, or I'll go to Chicago tomorrow. I refers to either to Sarita or to the person who is saying the utterance, that is to the speaker. That is because we are not in English, in Indian languages, we do not strictly follow the principle of changing the pronoun in consonance with the pronoun of the embedded clause, in consonance with the subject of the matrix clause. The next parameter we are going to discuss is the absence of expletive or pleonastic expressions such as it or there in English. In English, with weather expressions, you have an it that occurs in the subject position, and this it is an expletive it, or as it is called in the government and binding framework and modern linguistic theories as a pleonastic it. That means it has no content. It is raining in Shimla. There are two its in English. One it is, it has meaning, semantic content. I saw it, I bought it. That it has a semantic content. When you say I bought it, I can ask, what did you buy? I bought a book. So that it can be questioned. Whereas it is raining in Shimla, it is an expletive. You cannot ask a question, what is raining in Shimla? The question is ungrammatical. So the it that occurs in English is only a gap filler, purely to fill the gap, to fulfill the restriction that every sentence must obligatorily contain a subject, and since is raining is a predicate and you require a writ, therefore you have a pleonastic it. And also there is another pleonastic expression, there. There are two theres in English. One there is the locational there. I saw it there. If you say, I can ask you, where did you see? That means the there you have said can be questioned by where. But take a sentence such as, there is a pleonastic there, and this there cannot be questioned. There is no one there in the room. The first there, what are you talking about? You are talking about in the room. There is no one there in the room. That there, second there, is an emphatic, pointing out to the position towards the room. And the first there has no meaning. There is no one there in the room. I cannot question it and say, where is no one in the room? Right? So, the point is, a pleonastic expression cannot be questioned. Basically, they are gap fillers. Let's take a corresponding example from Hindi. Dilli mein barish ho rahi hai. Dilli mein, in Delhi, barish, noun, rain, ho is happen, rahi hai, progressive, hai is, rahi is progressive, hai is present tense. Delhi mein barish ho rahi hai. There cannot be a pleonastic expression like wo in such expressions in Hindi or in any South Asian language. That is, there are no pleonastic expressions in any South Asian language, irrespective of the fact whether the language is verb final or whether the language is non-verb final, like Khasi, Panar, Manar, etc. of the Mon Khmer's family, spoken in Meghalaya. So Hindi mein, let's look at in Hindi. Bagiche mein mor baitha hua hai. There is a peacock sitting in the garden. The there cannot be translated. Let's look at another sentence from Bangla. Agartala te borsha hoche. In Agartala, it is raining. It corresponds to Hindi. Agartala mein barish ho rahi hai. Now what is interesting? Khasi is a verb medial language. In Khasi too, when you have an weather expression like it is cold, it is raining, or it is hot, etc., you don't have an expletive it. Though Khasi is verb medial like English, that means having an expletive expression has nothing to do with the word order, that is verb medial or verb final. So let's look at this one. Kabneng ka khriyat. Kabneng, heaven, khriyat. Ka is your final singular. In Khasi, nouns are masculine or feminine, like in Hindi. So bring, heaven is feminine. So ka is the marker for feminine singular. And the verb also exhibits agreement in number and gender. So you have ka kriyat, feminine singular, ka kriyat, cold. That means in Khasi also you don't have expletive expression like it. So let's now conclude. In this module we have discussed the various syntactic phenomena that provide evidence in support of the notion of India as a linguistic area. And what are the features that we have discussed? The quotative. And the quotative is a right peripheral complementizer that occurs when the embedded clause is a finite clause and it carries a finite verb. We have seen that the quotative performs not only the function of a complementizer, it works like a reason adverb, manner adverb, in naming and labeling, etc. And this is due to the process of grammaticalization. And we have also discussed the conjunctive participle construction, where the conjunctive participle performs a number of functions. We have discussed compound verbs, conjunct verbs, reduplication and echo words, which are very robust phenomena in South Asian languages. Then we have also discussed prodrop. In prodrop we have shown that when you have an embedded subject that co-refers to the matrix subject in a complement clause, prodrop is obligatory in a language such as Telidiye or Angami spoken in Nagaland, and it's possible that it could be there in other languages too, but that needs to be checked. Another important point we have seen is prodrop is not as an optional rule that we thought. It has to be an obligatory rule. This we have discussed in the earlier unit when we talked about backward and forward control. Thank you.